Hey folks, before we get started, just a quick reminder that if you like what you hear today, please go ahead and click the subscribe button so you don't miss out on any future episodes. And if you happen to be listening on Apple Podcasts, be sure to rate and leave us a review so we know how we're doing. We'd love it if you did. Okay, now, on with the show. Hello, McFly. Welcome to the Film Nuts Podcast. I'm your host, Taylor D. Adams. We all have those movies we've seen a million times. Those movies we can recite from heart or act out from memory. Those experiences that bring smiles to our faces and shine a cinematic warmth on our souls. And today's topic is no exception. Released 35 years ago this July, Back to the Future has stood the test of time. It has become a classic for people in my generation and arguably others as well. It's a witty sci-fi comedy rooted in relatable characters with an eccentric scientist and a time-traveling DeLorean. There are a ton of reasons why I love this movie, but we're not here for me. Today's guest is filmmaker Kieran Moreira, and Back to the Future is his favorite movie of all time. Kieran joins me to talk about how this movie affected him in both personal and professional ways, one of which comes in the form of his latest short film, GILL, which is now streaming. And he's got another film coming out called Merit Badges, which will be released on June 4th. Full disclosure, I actually worked on one of these films for Kieran, but I promise this isn't shameless self-promotion. Well, not completely. But anyway, here's Kieran Moreira talking Back to the Future on the Film Nuts Podcast.
Worked on this film called GILL, which you were the editor on, so Aww. We're thankful for your involvement. But yeah, we released that April 2nd online, and that film has been like 3 years in the making. We shot it back in 2016, and it took 2 years to edit and get all the VFX in there, and finally went through the film festival circuit and get it online. So it's been really great. I've been getting some good responses online, and it is pretty scary to like share it with a larger audience because, you know, not everyone's going to like it. You get fun YouTube comments that you're like, okay, whatever, dude.
Have you gotten any thumbs downs?
Oh, yes. Yes.
That's how you know you made it.
Exactly. Yeah. You know, the first one I got, it just said, sucked. And I was like, okay. Thanks for your film commentary.
Yeah. Thanks.
So it's been interesting to release online on YouTube, but it's certainly opened up a lot of doors in terms of getting to a larger audience. And the second film we're launching on June 4th is Merit Badges, which I'm also really excited to get out there because I think that's going to be a completely demographic of people that will want to watch that film. So we'll see what happens.
Nice. I'm excited to see Merit Badges for sure. So I'm super excited that you wanted to talk about Back to the Future. when you sent me a list of things you wanted to talk about, I was like, I think I told you I liked almost everything on there, like The Witch. I was like, hell yeah, I'm down for that. But yeah, if whatever is your favorite, that's what I want to talk to you about. So tell me why Back to the Future is your favorite movie of all time.
Oh man, so many reasons. The music, the score is fantastic. Alan Silvestri. It's got a DeLorean that is a time machine. I mean, who does not love that concept? So cool. It's got a great cast. I mean, Christopher Lloyd and Michael J. Fox, what a duo in there. And they have some great dialogue together. Oh man, there's just so many things about this movie that's like action-packed, funny. It's got a great message and moral of the story. I don't know, there's just so many good things about it.
I'm telling the truth, Doc. You gotta believe me.
Then tell me, future boy, who's president of the United States in 1985?
Ronald Reagan.
Ronald Reagan? The actor? Then who's vice president? Jerry Lewis?
I suppose Jane Wyman is a first lady.
Whoa, wait, Doc.
And Jack Benny is Secretary of the Treasury.
Doc, you gotta listen to me.
I got enough practical jokes for one evening. Good night, future boy.
No, wait, Doc. Doc, the bruise. The bruise in your head. I know how that happened. You told me the whole story. You were standing on your toilet, and you were hanging a clock, and you fell, and you hit your head on the sink. And that's when he came up with the idea for the flux capacitor, which is what makes time travel possible.
When did you first see this? Who were you with?
So I was trying to think back on when I've seen this movie the first time. And the one thing I can definitively say is I've seen this a million times. But I cannot pinpoint the exact moment where I watched it for the first time. I have a distinct memory of my brother and I riding in our mom and dad's Toyota Previa, if you remember that egg-shaped van.
Okay,
we're riding down to Wilmington, and we have maybe a 10-inch TV that's in between the seats, and it has a VHS player.
Mm-hmm.
We're watching Back to the Future while driving down to the beach. And that is the first memory I have of watching this movie.
What did you, it's hard for you, as you said, to pinpoint kind of the first time, but if you attribute it to a specific memory, do you remember in the moment why you liked it?
Yeah, actually, it's funny. I rewatched it on last Friday in anticipation of this discussion, and mm-hmm. it gave me some time to reflect on what is the reason I liked this movie as a kid? And what's the reason I like this as an adult? And they're actually very different.
Mm-hmm.
So as a kid, I think, it has to do with time travel. So obviously there's the cool factor of a DeLorean going back to the past. But I think as a kid, I was always obsessed with the idea of what if you could change your life
mm-hmm.
and fix the mistakes that you could potentially make?
Mm-hmm.
And I think that has to stem with being a high strung kid. If you're in middle school or there's this added pressure of doing good on grades or you'll mess up your whole life. Everything feels so definite. And if you don't do this right here now, it's going to set you on a course to somewhere bad that you don't want to go. So I've always been obsessed with that idea, I think, as a kid.
You talk about being an anxious, how anxious of a kid were you? were you diving into something like that?
Yeah. So I was in a Catholic school from kindergarten to high school.
Okay.
And I remember they had a demerit system. You'd get demerits if you acted up. And I can say that I never got a demerit my entire time I was in kindergarten through 12th grade. And you could get a demerit for stuff you were talking in class or something like that.
Uh-huh.
So I was so fearful of getting just one that I was just completely the shy, timid kid that I wasn't going to say anything or act out because I didn't want to screw up anything if I got one demerit.
So this is super fascinating because I feel like it's sometimes the rebellious kids that end up leaning toward more artistic careers sometimes. And you are definitely in an artistic career, but you were a rule follower all through school. did you rebel at all ever?
I'm still a rule follower. I'm always on time. I don't like when people don't follow the rules. So it is really funny to be in this field.
I rewatched this movie last night, obviously to talk about this. And actually, probably a couple hours ago, I finished 2 and 3. I went ahead. I was just I'm going to go ahead and watch 2 and 3. And the cool part is I think 2's super dark. Part 2 is super dark. Part 3 is not up to par with where some people want it. But if you watch, I watched all 3 in the span of 24 hours. And as a trilogy, it actually is pretty tight. The only thing I don't like about it is the very end, but everything else is this is actually, this actually holds up pretty well. What do you think? What are your opinions on kind of this whole trilogy? We'll go ahead and start with all the trilogy.
Yeah. You can't really talk Back to the Future without bringing the other two in. I will say it's really interesting. As someone who studies filmmaking now, one of the things that's really key in the first movie is that you have a flat character arc with Marty.
Mm-hmm.
He's not the one that changes in that movie. He may learn some of the lessons, but the real lessons learned are from George, his father, in changing his life completely.
I still don't understand. How am I supposed to go to the dance with her if she's already going to the dance with you? Because, George, she wants to go with you. She just doesn't know it yet. That's why we got to show her that you, George McFly, are a fighter. You're somebody who's going to stand up for yourself, somebody who's going to protect her.
Yeah, but I've never picked a fight in my entire life.
Look, you're not going to be picking a fight, Dad. Daddy-o. You're coming to a rescue, right?
What's cool about that, though, is 2 and 3 were made at the exact same time, I think, like, back to back.
Yeah.
And that character arc pays off. It's much more active in Marty's life, and it pays off through 2 and 3. And it kind of, you see him facing off against Needles at the very end of the movie, and you can see the lessons he's learned throughout the course of the story.
Yeah, and that was super interesting too, because watching 2 and knowing about 3 at the time, you can notice all these things that are happening during 2 that lead into 3. And probably at the time, because I can't remember the first time I saw this movie either, but I remember never really connecting the dots chronologically. It was, and maybe even referentially, it was more of like, I knew of events, but not specific references. But yeah, going back to the character thing, like, yeah, the big character arc for 1 is not the main character, which I think is super interesting. But then leads to Marty himself having his own character arc, the main character, for the remainder of the trilogy. Now, correct me if I'm wrong. So Needles, played by Flea, was he in the first one?
No, he's not. Okay. He's not in the first movie. He appears in the second.
Yeah, right. Yeah, I remember that because I remember him coming up and Jennifer going like, is that Needles? And I was like, who the hell is Needles? And apparently she knew, I guess they were aware of this character in their own universe that we weren't aware of yet. And I wanted to make sure I didn't miss anything because I was super confused for a second.
Yeah, no, he does not appear. The main antagonist is Biff. The first one.
Yeah. What do you think? You said earlier that this first movie, we'll go back to this first movie. We'll talk about this one. You said it had a really good message. What's the message that you gleaned from this?
Right. So I think the takeaway as a kid was you can change your mistakes or fix your mistakes. But as an adult, upon watching it this time, I get something very different. And that message is perseverance. Mm-hmm. It's the idea of putting your mind to anything so that you can accomplish it. And it's really not giving up. I mean, you see at the beginning of the movie, Marty tries out for this, you know, the school performance with his band, and he gets rejected. And immediately he's questioning himself. He's like, I don't, what if they don't like me? What if I make a demo and no one cares? I mean, it kind of goes back to, like, you know, us putting stuff on YouTube and we get like debilitating comments from people. But, you know, and his girlfriend saying, well, you know, you should give it a shot. Like, you can't just let rejection, you know, fuel you the whole way. And that's the same lesson that George learns later when he's writing his science fiction theater and he doesn't want to show Marty the drafts. And, you know, even Marty's like, wow, I had no idea you were creative, because you never wanted to share any of that with anyone because you were so afraid.
Mm-hmm. What are you writing? Stories, science fiction stories about visitors coming down to Earth from other planets. Get out of town. I didn't know you did anything creative. Well, let me read some. Oh, no. I never let anybody read my stories. Why not? Well, what if they didn't like them? What if they told me I was no good? I guess that would be pretty hard for somebody to understand. No, not hard at all.
So it's an interesting lesson, just in the idea of perseverance.
Do you think, I mean, we can obviously assume your tone and my tone that we both believe that this movie holds up. And going back and for this podcast, for sure, watching older movies, I'm constantly looking to see if there's something about it from a creative standpoint that holds up, if there's something about it from a sensitivity standpoint that still holds up, or do we question anything? And I think for the most part, this movie is still like good to watch, okay to watch. One of the things that I had forgotten about up until about 5 minutes before it was happening is that George was actually a peeping Tom, and Marty calls him out on it. He's like, what? My dad was this? But George's transformation into becoming a person that is more confident, believing in himself, takes him from being a pervy recluse to being an actual, like, good person, which I think is an arc that I don't think we talk a lot about. And going back to what you're saying about this is basically George's story, and he's just got his son helping him out. Do you think there's something in that? I actually jotted this down. Is there something about this movie that can teach parents to learn from their children?
That's really interesting.
Like, it's kind of, it's a little on the nose, I think, with Marty literally teaching, like, George how to do certain things, but George unknowingly learning from his son because he doesn't know that he is his son. Do you think there's some kind of merit to that, or am I just kind of like bouncing spitballs off the wall?
No, I like that idea. I'd never thought of it, and of course, not being a parent myself, certainly it shapes my perspective on that story. But I think you're going in an interesting direction in terms of that logic. I have to think on that.
I also thought it was a good way to also recognize how maybe kids should try better to understand their parents. Like, there's so many, like, parental offspring relationships going on, and neither one of them are really understanding each other or almost benefiting each other either. They're just kind of in existence. Like, it painted this world of, you know, their family in 1985 is not a well-to-do family. They're struggling a little bit. Like, they're trying their best, but they're struggling, but they're generally unhappy. And it's all from kind of a fear standpoint and a settling standpoint. So I was just thinking about that, because, like, going back to these movies that we love as kids, like, I'm determined to go back and watch them and be like, okay, what else is here that I missed other than cool time travel? Doc is a little crazy. Ziplining from a clock tower, like, just fun stuff like that. Yeah,
has connections to the Libyans for some reason.
Yeah.
We don't understand why.
Yeah. Like, I guess at the time, Libyan terrorism was a thing. I don't know. but that was fascinating to me. And then I think there was, yes, I wrote down one other thing too, is that, like, what if you, this was super specific having to do with time travels. Like, what if you knew, like, personally, Kieran, what if you knew when lightning would strike exactly? Like, what if you knew something was exactly going to happen at the exact same time? Like, do you think you'd put yourself in a position to capitalize on it, or would you kind of deem that the universe has to run its course?
I'd say my younger self would have definitely said, we have to go back and fix something. Because, you know, we have to try to control everything.
Mm-hmm.
And I think maybe that's the point of the movie, is that things are out of your control no matter how much you do. Even Marty trying to go back and fix his parents' interaction, it unknowingly created an alternate course where everyone is completely changed. And being willing to accept that and to, you know, just go with it, I think that's the lesson that I feel like I take away, is that in life there are these things that are just going to happen to you, and you have to be willing to just roll with it.
Hey, you, get your damn hands off.
Oh, I think you got the wrong car, McFly.
George, help me, please.
Just turn around, McFly, and walk away. Are you deaf, McFly? Close the door and beat it.
No, Biff. You leave her alone.
All right, McFly. You're asking for it.
What was your favorite part? What was your favorite part of this movie?
So, I mean, I think the clock tower sequence, you mentioned it earlier, that's fantastic. Where they're racing to get the cable together and Doc has to slide down that sequence. But I think, again, this last watch, it's really appreciating that the musical score and the opening shot. I don't know if you remember the shot. And I feel like I always missed that shot as a kid because it came on TV and it was already like 20 minutes into the movie or something
right.
like that. So you never really appreciated that opening shot, but it really does a great job of just kind of easing into this story and setting up. It's like a 3 minute one take.
Yeah. Yeah. I think I had forgotten about that too. And as it was happening, I was like, I think I do remember this. And then I think when the first cut happened, I paused it and I looked and it was like, 3 minutes in. And I was like, that's impressive. I didn't even notice that.
Yeah. But you get so much information from that one shot. I mean, it's obviously the very overt theme of time with all the clocks, but you get a little, Easter egg of the man hanging from the clock tower needle, which obviously foreshadows Doc, but you also get a sense of what Doc has been doing and what kind of person he is because it's this almost Rube Goldberg machine, but it doesn't quite work properly.
Which yeah.
is a reflection of a lot of his inventions, unfortunately.
Yeah.
But it's really ingenious and cool. And you can see what he's made even for Marty with the amplifier and stuff like that. So you can kind of understand their relationship a lot more just from that opening shot.
I sometimes forget how much this score is ingrained in my memory. I think it was last fall. Me and my girlfriend went down to Universal Studios in Florida and we're waiting in line to get into the park and they're playing all like major movie themes from all the Universal movies. And as soon as I hear the first like couple chords of this theme, I'm like, oh, this is Back to the Future. Like, and for some reason I was like, oh yeah, John Williams did this. And I'm like, no, John Williams didn't do this. This was Alan Silvestri. I was like, I don't know how, I think it's just because I always, attribute any Steven Spielberg-y thing sometimes with a John Williams. But hearing that name reminding me at the opening credits of Alan Silvestri, I was like, oh, this guy is also a big player. This guy has also made a ton of different movie soundtracks. Like Forrest Gump's probably up there too, one of my favorites that he's done. But that's such an interesting thing that this theme, music, movie themes can have a big impact on like your memory. Like you might not even remember that if somebody said, sing me the theme from Back to the Future, you might not be able to like do it. But if you heard it, you would immediately recognize it.
Absolutely. And it's interesting too, that it only appears like, 10, 11 minutes into the film, like you kind of forget that it really only appears when that DeLorean comes off the truck for the first time. And I think because it's so isolated from that point on, it makes it that much more special when you start to hear it for the first time.
Welcome to my latest experiment. This is a big one, the one I've been waiting for all my life.
Well, it's a DeLorean, right?
Bear with me, Marty. All your questions will be answered. Roll tape.
Okay,
I will proceed.
Doc, is that a Devo?
Never mind that now. Not now. All right, I'm ready.
Good evening. I'm Dr. Emmett Brown. I'm standing on the parking lot at Twin Pines Mall. It's Saturday morning, October 26, 1985,
1:18 a.m.
And this is temporal experiment number one.
Is this a movie that you have to, I mean, this is a classic. We can both agree on that for sure. Is this a movie that you have had to turn anyone onto that like hadn't seen it and you were kind of shocked?
I am surprised at people who have never seen this movie. I feel like it's on TV so much that you can't miss it, but yeah, it is something. If I've ever heard someone say, oh, I've never seen Back to the Future. Like, well, we got to watch it like right now. Cause I've got the Blu-ray with all the extended content. Like we're going to watch it.
So educate me, since you have that Blu-ray with all that extra content, have you gone through all the content? What have you learned?
So that Blu-ray came out in, I think, 2010. I mean, the fascinating stuff is the stuff with Eric Stoltz, who was the lead before Michael J. Fox. Actually took on the role of Marty, and they filmed a bunch of scenes with him already. And it was just interesting to hear the Bobs, Robert Zemeckis and Bob Gale talk about that decision to remove him you know, remove Eric because it just wasn't working. Mm-hmm. Like, it's just too serious. I read on IMDb, he was a character actor, a method actor, and he wanted to be called Marty all the time. And he was very difficult to work with and was actually like being really physical with Biff, the actor.
Yeah.
So that learning all the behind the scenes stuff and the politics just to try to get Michael J. Fox to do the movie was fascinating to me.
Have you seen this? I forgot what the celebration was, but Josh Gad held like a Zoom meeting with Christopher Lloyd and all that. Did you check it out? What was that? I missed that.
Yeah. So I'm not familiar with Josh Gad's show, but I did come across this, and basically it's just a reunion where they bring back, you know, Christopher Lloyd and Michael J. Fox together, and then they slowly introduce the rest of the cast, like Leah Thompson and stuff like that.
Yeah.
They basically just reflect on the movie, you know, some of their favorite moments, and the Bob say, you know, what's the chance of doing another Back to the Future movie? And like, not in our lifetime.
Yeah. Do you think this movie is going to have to succumb to the inevitable remake somewhere down the line?
I really hope not. I mean, I think I got a glimpse of that in Ready Player One. I know it's not a remake, but there's that element of nostalgia, of movie nostalgia, that was kind of like reinvigorated into the present day pop culture, you know, with the DeLorean and some of the music and stuff like that. But I really don't know how you could do this story unless it was just completely different cast and crew. And I feel like that kind of waters down the original, so to speak.
Yeah. I mean, I agree with you too, but that hasn't stopped a lot of studios from remaking franchises with brand new actors, brand new talent and all this other stuff. So I don't know. Going back to, you were talking about a specific memory you had watching this movie. So you don't remember, I mean, obviously, never mind. That was a dumb question. I was like, you don't remember a theater memory, but obviously this movie came out before we were both.
I went back to the future and watched this movie in a theater.
And you can't count how many times you've seen this movie. What about, was it something that you watched with your family a lot?
I think it was something I watched with my brother a lot.
Yeah. You
know, I texted him in anticipation of this movie, and I was like, hey, you know, like, do you remember watching this with me? And he said, yeah, I remember we had a skateboard that had a handle on it. It reminded me of like Michael J. Fox skateboarding around Hill Valley and making me feel like I was Marty.
Did you watch a lot of movies? Like, were you and your brother, was that like your movie watching partner pretty much?
Yeah, he's 2 years younger than me, so that age difference, like, is very conducive to, like, you know, we'd always play around. And I think that's the playtime with him was actually like my introduction into filmmaking, because we got my dad's, you know, VHS camera, and we decided we were going to make a Matrix style fan film where I literally would, you know, do in-camera editing with him and, you know, have him disappear out of frame like he's entering the Matrix, because that was pretty popular, you know, when we were growing up. I definitely think, like, he and I, you know, we grew up together watching movies and appreciating them.
Do you think this movie shaped who you are as a filmmaker, as an artist?
Oh, absolutely. I recently, in GILL, which is it's about a malfunctioning teleportation suit, the ideation of the suit was actually based on the DeLorean. It was it was the shorthand I used to the costume designer when I said, hey, you know, in Back to the Future, the DeLorean is a prototype. It is not finished. It, you know, it has wires exposed. That's how I want my teleportation suit to feel and look like. It's not refined in any way. So absolutely. I think I'm always in the back of my subconscious referencing this movie and making my own films.
So what other, I mean, I imagine you have more than one influence. Like, what are kind of your key movies that kind of help shape you?
Ooh, I mean, it's hard not to, you know, growing up, not to reference like Steven Spielberg, and obviously he had a hand in Back to the Future, but I recently read Jurassic Park. And again, I think that's another like techno sci-fi movie that like, I can think about enacting. Like, my brother and I had a bunch of woods in our backyard, and we pretended we were in Jurassic Park because that was such like a big influential movie. So that's like an immediate inspiration to me is the Spielberg movies of that era.
Yeah, I remember when Jurassic Park came out. I mean, it was when I was super into, you know, dinosaurs. We're all into dinosaurs. And I'm like, oh, I want to see this movie. And it was the first movie that my mom was like, really wanted, like she wanted me to see it because I wanted to see it, but she was super hesitant about it. And so she went and saw it with my stepdad. And I think she said for the most part, it was like, okay, but there was a moment where there's a moment in Jurassic Park when I forgot what character, but they're up in the ceiling and the velociraptor in the kitchen jumps up toward the ceiling. The woman next to my stepdad leaped out of her chair like dug her nails into his arm. And that was like a moment for my mom and stepdad to be like, okay, maybe it's a little too scary. But like later on, like we rented it on VHS and watched it in the family. I was like, oh yeah, this is fun. This is great. This is awesome.
Yeah. Yeah. It's a great movie. And what's funny is it's actually not that violent. I mean, I don't know how you felt about it as a kid, mm-hmm. but like reading the book recently, which is way gorier than the movie, I feel like it's more of an adventure to me. I don't see it as like a horror film or anything like that. Or it has horror elements, but I don't find it scary.
Yeah, I would agree too. Like, I think the first time I watched it, I wasn't scared by it. I was just like, I jumped because there are parts where you jump, but for the most part, I just thought it was a cool, fun movie about dinosaurs.
Absolutely.
Yeah. If they did make a Back to the Future remake, would you want to direct it?
Ooh. I mean, I did just say that I didn't want to do that, but now you've given me the keys to the DeLorean, so to speak. So, I mean, I could not, not pass up that offer to remake it. I'd have to get somewhat creative in how we'd bring back maybe some of the older characters or figure out, ways to introduce new characters. Maybe it's Needles. Maybe that's the spot where we follow Needles' backstory.
I feel like Flea would be up for that.
Oh, totally.
Yeah, he would totally be down for that. And there'd probably be cameos from the rest of the Red Hot Chili Peppers, too.
That would be fantastic. Oh, you could go back to when they were popular and then, when the Red Hot Chili Peppers were playing and then there'd be this weird crossover section.
That would be wild. I'm trying to think if there's any other questions I have. That's basically it. We try to keep this pretty short. Is there anything that kind of you want to touch on that maybe we haven't asked about what you like about this movie or just something you want to point out?
I feel like we touched on a lot of stuff. I mean, I think just that lesson learned of, it's like you can accomplish anything if you put your mind to it. That's a beautiful message and something I truly appreciate as a creative now more than ever than I did as a kid. So that gives me inspiration to this day.
That's awesome. Awesome, man. Well, thanks for joining me. I really appreciate it.
Yeah, thanks, Taylor. I really appreciate the time.
No problem. I'll talk to you later.
See ya.
I love everything about Back to the Future. The dynamic between Doc and Marty, the examples of the little guy taking down a big bad, the musical number, and just how much fun this damn movie is. I'm pretty sure I've got a dumb grin on my face the entire time I'm watching it. Whether it's quoting the movie in real time or reveling in George punching Biff, even though I know by now that it isn't a surprise, this movie never gets old. I really want to thank Kieran for talking with me, and if you want to know more about his films, check out the episode notes. And as you can tell from my discussion with Kieran, a movie can take on different meanings for different people, and all interpretations can be valid, because art is subjective. But it is our love for art that has the potential to connect us all. So, here's what I'm proposing. Watch a movie or an episode of a show with someone, if it's safe to do so. If not, try the Netflix Party Browser extension, which I'll link to in the episode notes as well. Watch something, and then talk about it. I mean, really talk about it. Why did you enjoy it? What did you relate or connect to? And if no one will watch what you want to, tweet at us, and we'll watch it with you. You can connect with us on Twitter at FilmNutsPodcast or email hello@filmnutspodcast.com. Be sure to subscribe so you don't miss out on any future episodes. And thanks so much for listening. Now, I'll let Doc send us off.
Hey, Doc, we better back up. We don't have enough roads to get up to 88.
Roads? Where we're going, we don't need roads.